Welcome to part 2 of the SSL TLS lecture series. Today we will start with the secure message transport. In cryptography, typically we will use two candidate allies and bug. Whenever we deal with the communication, always we will talk about allies and bug. So I will also use the same two people for my example. Let's say if allies wants to send a message to bug over the network. So this is her message M. In order to securely transport the message, we need certain properties. For example, an outsider, for example, let's say Oscar is an outsider. The outsider should not be able to see what is the message content. This property is called confidentiality. That is, an outsider should not be able to see what is the message. So confidentiality can be achieved by using encryption. Of course, the other party will decrypt the message to see what the message is. So confidentiality is provided using encryption function. The second property that we need is the outsider should not be able to tamper the message. So let's say he takes the message and tamper something. So to prevent that, we need to use some mechanism to check the integrity of the message. So avoiding the tampering of message or detecting the tampering of the message is provided by the integrity checking function. Typically, we use something called hash function to check the integrity of a message. Don't worry about the hash now. When it comes, I will deal with it. The third property we need is called authenticity of the message. Authenticity means if Bob receives a message from Alice, Bob should be 100% sure that it is really coming from Alice and not from some outsider. So that's what we mean by authenticity. That is a guarantee of the sender. It is really coming from the sender, Alice. There are some primitives available to provide the authenticity of a message. For example, in SSL TLS, we will use what is called a message authentication code in order to provide authenticity of the message. In fact, the MAC algorithm provides both authenticity as well as the integrity of the message, because if it is really coming from Alice, then automatically it guarantees the integrity as well, because the moment the outsider touches the message, then it is no longer coming from Alice, right? So authenticity automatically guarantees the integrity of the message as well. Okay. The fourth property is called non-repudiation. Non-repudiation means after Alice send the message to Bob, later Alice cannot say I did not send the message. So we need a guarantee for that. That property is what we call as non-repudiation. That is, after you're sending the message, the sender cannot deny that he didn't send the message. That is called non-repudiation. Later we will see how to achieve non-repudiation. For example, typically we will achieve non-repudiation using what is called a public key cryptography and digital signature. Don't worry about all these things at the moment. When we deal with the public key cryptography, I will explain all these things. The fifth property we need is called replay attack protection. That is no replay. Replay means an attacker can capture a valid communication which is happening between Alice and Bob, and later Alice is gone, he can replay this message to the Bob. So that's what we mean by replay attack. So there are some primitives available to prevent the replay attack. So later we will see all these things in elaborate detail. So in order to perform a secure message transport, we need confidentiality, integrity, authenticity, non-repudiation, no replay attack. So later we will see how we will try to achieve this during a SSL TLS communication. Okay, let's take the first thing, confidentiality. I told you, confidentiality can be obtained using encryption of the message. The area which deals with encryption and decryption of the message is called cryptography. Actually, cryptography is a subset of a broad area called cryptology. Cryptology has two children. The first child is called cryptography. The second child is called cryptanalysis. So, cryptanalysis is nothing but how to break the encryption in order to find the plain text or to recover the key. That is the job of the cryptanalysis. So, the people who do this is called cryptanalyst. Cryptanalyst. Okay. So, for the time being, we won't deal with the cryptanalysis. We will focus on the little bit basics about cryptography. In cryptography, let's say you have a message. The message is typically called plain text. So you have your plain text. You want to provide confidentiality to the plain text. So what you typically do is, you will use what is called an encryption function. The output is going to be a ciphertext. So you have your plain text. You will encrypt the plain text. You will get a ciphertext output. In order to do this, you need the help of a key. The key is here. I am going to use the key as K. Okay. There are some algorithms available called key generators. So in cryptography, we use a key generator which will usually produce a random key. It is extremely important to produce a random key. The moment you provide any predictability in the output of the key generator, it is dangerous. Okay, we will deal about all those things a bit later. Okay, so encryption is typically, it can be written as, let's say I am using encryption using key K of a plain text and I will get a ciphertext. Similarly, you take the ciphertext, you provide a decryption function using the key and you will get back your plain text. In this particular example, I use the same key both for encryption as well as for decryption. In such cases, it is called symmetric cipher. There is another method available which use different key for encryption and decryption. That is called asymmetric cipher. We will deal about it a bit later. Okay. In cryptography, the modular arithmetic is extremely important. Throughout the cryptography, you will repeatedly see modular arithmetic. So what is a modular arithmetic? In simple terms, a modulo operation is nothing but you divide a number and take a remainder. Let's say you take a number 10. I will divide the number by 3. I will get the quotient. I will divide this number by 3, right? 3 times 3, 9. So remainder 1. So this reminder can be created using what is called a modulo operator. In many programming languages, the percentage symbol will act as a modulo operator. So 10 modulo 3 means you divide 10 by 3 and take the remainder. This remainder is 1, right? So this is what we mean by modulo operation. The number you are using for division is called modulus. For example, in this operation, 3 is called the modulus. Don't worry too much. You are using the modulo arithmetic almost every day. Whenever you look at the wall clock, we all know that, right? Wall clock, even though we have 24 hours day, the typical wall clock only have up to 12, right? So you have up to 12. So when you reach the 13 hours, automatically you are converting. You are dividing it by 12 and taking the remainder 1. You are calling it as 1 p.m., right? So a wall clock is a perfect example of a modulo 12 operation. You are performing a mod 12 operation. In dealing with encryption decryption, this modulo 2 addition is extremely important function. So what is modulo 2 addition? It's a normal addition of two binary digits. Only that whatever output you are getting, you take a mod 2 of this. Let's take the first example. So these two are binary bits. So we have only two binary bits, right? 0 and 1. So there are maximum 4 combinations. You can either add a 00, or you can add a 01, or you can add a 10, or you can add a 11. You only can get 4 combinations out of two binary digits, right? So let's take the first one. If you add 0 and 0, of course you will get a 0. If you perform your modulo operation by 2, you will again get a 0. Okay. The next equation, you take 0 plus 1, the output is going to be 1. You take a modulo 2, so 1 modulo 2 is again nothing but 1. Then 1 plus 0. 1 plus 0 is nothing but 1. Again, if you take modulo, of course, you are going to get 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. 2 modulo 2, you are going to get a 0. Usually, when we deal with modulo operation, we will not use the symbol equal to. Instead, we will use the symbol called congruent. Congruent is nothing but equivalent. It means equivalent. 2 modulo 2 is equivalent to 0. Okay? So, don't worry about all these mathematics now. So, there is an important lesson here. When you perform your mod 2 operation, there are only 4 possibilities, right? 2 possibilities produce a 0 and another 2 possibilities produce 1. That means the probability of getting a 0 is 50%, right? That is, out of 4 combinations, 2 times you get a 0. That means 0.5, right? 1 by 2 is 0.5, that is 50%. The probability of getting a 0 is 50%. The probability of getting a 1 out of 4 combinations, twice you are getting the 1, right? So, the probability of getting a 1 is also equivalent to 50%. That is, when you perform a mod 2 addition, the output is going to be a unpredictable one. The probability of getting a 0 and 1 is going to be 50-50. So, that is an important property when you wanted to do encryption. We will come back to this property a bit later. So, because of this particular property that the output is always equiprobable, probability of getting a 0 and 1 is always 50-50, that's why it can act as a very good encryption function. One of the key requirements for an encryption function is the output should be always equiprobable. No one should be able to predict what will be the output. It should have perfect 50-50 prediction. Okay. Mod 2 addition has another name. It is also called XOR operation. The good thing about this XOR operation is it is very easy to implement in hardware as well as in software. For example, in hardware, when we deal with XOR, right, typically the XOR gate is something looks like this. If you are coming from the digital electronics background, this is what is called a XOR gate. Let's say you have input X1, input X2. Let's call the output Y, right? So your input is X1, X2. Your output is Y, okay? So if you give 0, 0, you will get a 0. If you give 0, 1, you will get a 1. If you give 1, 0, you will get a 1. If you give 1, 1, you will get a 0, okay? So that is a XOR gate, the job of the XOR gate. So, if you look at this with the previous modulo 2 addition, it is exactly same, right? That's why we call modulo 2 addition is nothing but a XOR operation, okay? It is typically written using the symbol plus with a circle. In many equations, if you see a circle inside a plus symbol, that represents a XOR operation. Sometimes you will also see another symbol. Instead of this, you see a square. Inside the square, you will see a plus symbol. This means a literal addition. It's not modulo to addition. It's a literal addition. Okay. So don't worry too much about this. So I told you that XOR can be used as an encryption function, right? So let's take an example. Let's say you have a message, right? Your plain text is equal to the number 3. You decided to use a key. Your key is going to be the number 9. Okay. So let's do the encryption. I told you the encryption is nothing but C equal to, you take the plain text, you XOR the plain text with your key, okay? So, what is P? What is 3? 3 is nothing but 0011. If I write using the binary system, this is nothing but 0011. So, 9 is nothing but 1001. This is 9. So, this is your 3. This is your plain text, right? This is your key. Your key is nothing but 9. So, I am using. Now I will perform a XOR operation. So 11 means 0. 10 means 1. 00 means 0. 01 means 1. So this is my output. So this is going to act as a ciphertext. This is my ciphertext. So how to decrypt this message is super simple. You again take the same key 9 and you again perform the encryption with XOR, that is 1001. You again perform your XOR operation with the ciphertext. So 01 is 1, 10 is 1, 00 is 0, 11 is 0. Look at this. This is nothing but 3. So you got back your plain text. So this way, the XOR operation can be used for both encryption as well as decryption. In fact, when you use the RC4 cipher, it is exactly doing what I said just now. So it is using the same thing for encryption and decryption. So XOR is a good encryption function. The reason is the output of a XOR operation will always produce equiprobable 50-50. For example, instead of XOR, let's say an AND operation. AND operation means you have input X1, X2, output Y. 00 means 0, 01 means 0, 10 means 0. Only 11 will produce a 1. That means the probability for getting a 0 out of 4, 3 times you will get a 0. Out of 4, only 1 times you will get a 1. So the probability here for is 75%, here only 25%. So they are not equiprobable. So it cannot act as a good encryption function. The same thing goes with the R. For example, if you take R operation, 00 will produce a 0, 10 will produce a 1, 01 will produce a 1, 11 will also produce a 1, right? That means probability for 0 is 25%, probability for 1 is 75%. So this fellow also cannot act as a good encryption function. Only XOR can act as a good encryption function. That's why XOR is very, very important in cryptography. Okay, we will stop here. So today we learned that for a secure message transport, we need certain qualities called confidentiality, integrity, authenticity. Then we learned non-repudiation and no replay attack. Okay, then we learned what is encryption, decryption. Both are covered by cryptography. And the art of breaking the encryption to recover the plain text or key is called cryptanalysis. These two, cryptography and cryptanalysis, comes under a broad area called cryptology. Okay. We learned that to perform encryption and decryption, you need a key. If you use the same key for both encryption and decryption, it's called a symmetric cipher. Whereas if you use a different key, it is called asymmetric cipher. Then we came to modular arithmetic. I told modular arithmetic is very important in cryptography. Your wall clock is a perfect example of mod 12 operation. A modular operation is nothing but take a number, divide it by another number. The remainder is called the modular operation. Whatever remainder you are getting. The number you are using to divide is called modulus. Okay, all these things we learn. In particular, mod 2 addition is very famous. Mod 2 addition has another name called XOR. The beauty of this is the probability of getting a 0 and 1 is 50-50. No other AND or OR operation can produce this. So XOR is an example of a good encryption function. So with this, today we will end this lecture. In the next episode, we will learn about symmetric ciphers. Thank you for joining today's lecture.